Welcome back from that short break. You're still watching Aben Today right here on Aben Television. It is time for Kachai, and like I mentioned earlier, we shall be talking about celebrating 9th of December, which is the International Anti-Corruption Day, according to the national and world calendar. Now, this morning, we're going to be talking about anti-corruption and vice that has been creeping our nation, and also news coming in as far as some different stats, according to the UN, show that $1 trillion US actually spent in bribes is every year as far as the corruption is concerned. I want to find out, why is it taking us so long to make sure that we kick out this vice? And is it actually possible and viable for an African country like Uganda to actually live without corruption? This morning, we shall be talking to Judah Odaro, the manager over the Uganda Debate Network. Good morning to you.
Good morning. How are you, Derek?
Very fantastic.
Yeah.
How is your Monday morning?
It's great. It's been rainy, wet.
It's been wet everywhere. Are you feeling, anti-corrupt in any kind of way?
Yes, I am. I'm excited. Every other time we have a conversation around corruption, we feel that probably the debate is heating up, and therefore everybody needs to take action. And especially our reinforcement to government is that we want to see government act more.
Because
while we talk about corruption, everybody talks about the effect of corruption, which they do feel each and every day.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of it all, yes, we have a responsibility, all of us, but whatever the bigger responsibility still lies with the government.
Okay.
Because it has got all the infrastructure, both political, legal, and institutional, to do the needful.
Now, Mr. Jude, now that you're in studio, I want us to, tackle this vice from the root cause of what exactly is corruption. And regarding to, the fact that there are very many people who are always watching us in the morning, and some people don't understand what corruption is. There's a video that went viral of a young man who was, being told the fact that the government is stealing his money. And to his, facts, he said, I have my money in my pocket. So what do you mean the government is stealing my money? Help us understand, what is the actual definition of corruption? And when we talk about corruption, as Ugandans who pay for our taxes, how fearful should we get?
Yeah, I think corruption is, corruption is basically an abuse of resources.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, we are focusing on the public resources.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, where resources are generated. From the generation, allocation of resources, the management of resources, and the accountability of these resources.
Okay.
Along the entire value chain of generation to accountability, as long as there is any diversion, there is an abuse of those resources, they are not delivering the outputs and the outcomes that we envisage at the end of the day, that is corruption. Of course, it takes different forms, bribery, real theft.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
When someone real steals,
yes,
public funds.
Uh-huh. There is diversion. Mm-hmm. Is that you got the money to buy a pen, but you end up buying a book.
Mm-hmm.
That is corruption.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yes.
Is obesity also a sign of corruption?
Obesity.
Not necessarily.
In our context of Uganda, that when they see that you have a parabolic stomach and you cannot account for it, then it can be associated with corruption.
Talking about obesity, that was one of the words that made headlines. When the president did his anti-corruption work, it was the 4th of December, another day that made history in the Ugandan calendar. Jude, what do you make of the anti-corruption work? Do you think this was something viable at the end of the day? Did we even need it? Do you feel it has left any significance out there to the public?
Yeah, the anti-corruption work is a good work, and it's not a new work, because civil society actors have been involved in the work.
Yes, yes.
And at different levels they have worked.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was incumbent upon government institutions to join the work. Because every other time the civil society actors worked, they thought they were just politicking and doing the politics.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So we're wondering whether government was doing the politics or they're actually doing the genuine work against corruption. I think the work was good, but the ups and downs of it are related in terms of if the head of the state gets involved.
Exactly.
It's a good political posture,
mm-hmm.
but there is a cost to it.
That's what I was going to ask. Has the budget leaked yet? Wala biyako kubudget iwe fanana?
There is a cost to it, to how much, for example, government spends to have that work, but also in terms of the impact on the private sector. This is the work would have been decentralized to local government, since local government level. I think that would be able to galvanize a lot of citizens' enthusiasm and support. Because how many people are up in the countryside watch TV on the morning day? How many people are able to listen to the radio
they
during the morning to be able to get the message? Probably they might have not even known about the walk. Okay. So the rest of us should be doing the walking while the head, the government should be doing the taking the decisive actions to demonstrate effective fight against corruption.
Interesting.
I'm interested in the debts we incur as a country. Are they necessary, really? Are we that poor to need to borrow?
Yes, debt. So the debt sometimes they are necessary debts, but they are also unnecessary debts. Okay. What is important is the appraisal process. How do you determine that you actually need the debt, and the debt for what purpose? If the process is done well, is that I think borrowing per se is not bad. It's a good thing because government operates like each one of us operates at home. Because there are always limitations. The desire to do so much is very high, but the ability and the capacity to effectively do that is limited, constrained by resources. So we don't have the latitude of enormous amount of resources to utilize at all times at our disposal. And therefore, the borrowing becomes the last resort. But the issue is about borrowing is that some of the borrowing has not been, is not necessary.
Exactly.
Okay. And the worst of it, or even the what has been borrowed, is that the performance of most of our loans is very, very poor. Some of the loans are performing at 10%, at 4%, at 20%, and that raises the bigger question if actually the borrowing is necessary. But otherwise, if the performance of our loans was doing exceptionally well and we're delivering quality goods and services, everybody would be excited that at least, yes, the debt is growing, but at least we have improvement in terms of the quality
of goods. Should Ugandans be worried about the debt? Because right now, as we speak, I think it is about 42 trillion Ugandan shillings.
Yes, we should be. We should be and extremely worried, and especially for the commercial debt. Okay. You know, every time you borrow at a commercial rate, the interest rates are very high.
Very high, yes.
And also the biggest fear that even when we borrow is that the performance of this is questionable, and therefore we're not reaping the dividends of the debt. For example, if you do a road that ordinarily should last 10 to 15, 20 years and last 5 years, you start maintaining the road even before
just 2 years.
So, I mean, let's look
and
at our bridge
the debt is 42 at about 43% of our GDP, and it's projected to grow probably by the the first half of the next financial year to about 48.
So the debt is going to be paid by 10 generations to come.
Absolutely. And it is our responsibility, all of us, to contribute towards the servicing of the debt. So and the biggest worry is that once debt creeps from the bottom of your priorities to the top of your priorities,
you
then
never you never stabilize.
None at all.
Mr. Jude, talking about service delivery, recently the Ministry of Disaster and Preparedness came up to say that the money that was allocated to them as far as, doing their main role, which is actually, being there prepared for the people that undergo this kind of circumstances whereby you have floods, landslides in areas of like Bududa, they came up to say that they needed more money to facilitate their budget, which triggered the government to say that they could be looking into borrowing money that is close to about 2.5 trillion Ugandan shillings. Is this the right way we should be handling our budget and also different ministries, to be very particular, the Ministry of Disaster and Preparedness?
Yeah, I think Ugandans generally, I think we are extremely disappointed with the performance of the sector in terms of mitigating the impact and impact of the disasters. We can't avoid them. They will always come and they are known. They are predictable. And the impact is predictable. But we should be investing a lot more into mitigating the impact.
Yes.
But I think that's where we failed. Everybody seems to be going to sleep and rest, enjoy the holiday, waiting for the disaster to strike.
The holiday.
And then all of a sudden, and everybody is crying, say, we don't have enough money, we can't respond. The response mechanisms are extremely weak because the structures haven't been set up at different levels of vulnerability to be able
that
to
that should have already been set up by
this
time,
So they don't exist. You look at local government disaster management committees that never sit. They don't understand their mandate as well. But the worst of all is that they are inadequately facilitated. And therefore, failure to facilitate these structures is actually crippling any efforts against mitigating the disaster.
We were having an argument with these teammates of mine about how the punishments for these thieves is being handled. Omuntu abadde abba sente z'omuwi w'omusolo bamukwata bamusiba busibi. Shouldn't there be a way of getting back those assets to the country? As in, bakukute, obadde ba, let's say, 500 billion.
Yeah.
Should we just lock you up or you should give it back?
Yeah, I think that was then previously the whatever the old the Anti-Corruption Act was amended, and the amendments, one of the amendments, the Anti-Corruption Act, is to provide for recovery of the stolen assets. And I think right now, in many of the cases, there is recovery, though they're still weak. Is that which also needs to be strengthened. I think the whole idea is that once you've stolen, you must recover. Imprisoning you is not enough. Because after 5, 7, 10 years, 3 years in prison, you're coming back to.
And we've already and spent enjoy. On you again.
We've already spent you in prison, taking care of you and maintaining you there, meeting your health and medical bills and your meals and welfare.
Yeah.
So therefore, I think that is what is happening. But the pace at which that is happening is still very low, because we haven't seen the latest report in terms of the recoveries. Yeah, much as you see the court rulings, they indicate that, you know, you're supposed to pay some 12 million. Yeah, so the recovery bit that needs to come out very clearly and. I was the discussion with the Inspector of Government, the IGG.
The IGG, yes.
And the impression they're creating that, no, they are doing a lot of work which is good, but they are doing it behind the doors, because they say they don't operate in the media. But the information needs
need
to come
to
out.
Know. People need to know. And then the same ones who collected over 25,000 reports.
Yes.
Eh? Then, yeah. Even now, we only have accountability to 5,000 of those 25 reports.
Exactly. So people, we want to know, the information must get out. As they produce their report to Parliament, there should be a special copy delivered to New Vision, to Urban TV and other places, so that people have the information and they help them raise this awareness, but also account for their performance.
Jude, talking about, you know, the institution, the IGG, you know, I want us to also bring it in light together with the Anti-Corruption Unit, which was launched a couple of months ago by the president. Do you feel like the IGG has actually let us down? Because for the president to launch the Anti-Corruption Unit, he said how much he was disappointed with the IGG's work, not being able to bring out these criminals to justice. And he said for that matter, he's appointing Lieutenant Colonel Edith Nakalema to head the Anti-Corruption Unit, which we've also seen its works. Nevertheless, it has tried to put them out there in the media, but we still have downfalls. I mean, Edith Nakalema herself came up to say that some people are untouchable. Do you think that the IGG's office has let us down as far as, you know, fighting corruption is concerned?
I think wouldn't say that, especially if you understand the nature of the institution and how it has worked and how it does work every day.
Okay.
You wouldn't come to a conclusion that he has let us down. Would say that they have made tremendous efforts, but also those efforts are constrained by a number of factors which are external. One of them in terms of the resources available to the Inspectorate of Government, both financial and human. There was an example, for example, of Jinja Regional Office, IG Regional Office, which is supposed to oversee anti-corruption efforts in 10 districts, but has a budget of about 6 million. That would mean 6 million a month. That would mean they have 200,000 available for them to go and follow up a case, do investigations in a district.
Just one case.
One case. Not just one case. There could be 1,000 cases that from, say, Kamuli. So for an officer leaving Jinja to go to Kamuli, he has only 200,000 available for them for a whole month. So which
that even puts that one in a position where they can be bribed.
Yes, so that is the money that is supposed to facilitate their movement, facilitate their accommodation and their contacts with the collect that. So they are basically constrained, and therefore failing to facilitate an institution is actually telling them that actually, no, if you first wait, your work is not yet as relevant as we would want it to be able to be able to perform. So IG is doing a job. But also that job is constrained by so many factors. Lack of financing, but also the mandate is also too broad. Is that how they have to do the cause investigations or conduct investigations. They have to cause arrests or undertake arrests. Cause prostitution or take on prostitution cases where they are not able to to solve some cases to be handled by other agencies, that they have a huge mandate, and therefore the coordination with other entities becomes a problem, which are all suffering from underfunding under the accountability sector. So cases that have they have referred to CIDD for investigations, they take ages to come out. So therefore, that impacts on their performance. Those that are with the DPP, if they are not being taken to court, and therefore it affects their performance. So part of it is a bigger problem that affects the whole accountability sector that needs to be addressed. Just looking at the IGJ alone with such a broad mandate,
they are bound not to deliver the dividends. Does that mean that it was a good move for us to form the, you know, the anti-corruption unit? Was it really viable? Did we need it as a nation?
I don't think so, personally, because I think the addressing the internal weaknesses within the institutions is not by creating additional layer. Of
after we had this conversation of merging different institutions together,
yes. It's like wife number one annoys you, so you get wife number two.
You get number two. If that one also annoys you, you do number three. At the end of the day, how many are you going to
100.
Have?
100.
Okay. And therefore, what is going to be the cost of maintaining and sustaining all these that are there? Because you haven't disbanded any, but you're just adding another layer after layer after layer. So I think basically, the issue was focusing it, going back to sit back and reflect where is the problem? Where, for example, say somebody say, where did the rain start beating us in this fight against corruption? So, and start the conversation from there and say, yeah, there is a weakness here. This is what we can do about it. Okay. We can fix here, as opposed to creating layers, because Nakalema is going to suffer the same fate that the inspector is facing. They're going to say, no, we have untouchable guys.
Yeah,
exactly. That was one of the
reasons. Mafia.
We have a mafia. Two is that our budget is very small. Now, if I'm going to report, I must report and make sure that I have sufficient evidence. For us, in our effort, in our campaign against corruption, is that we have encouraged citizens to report. And the reporting, monitor and report. You see, when you do the monitoring, is that you the information that you report is basic. I have seen, I have heard, I have been told. Okay? I have this, you know, this gray evidence that is not concrete. What do I do is give the information to Derek, who has the powers to do the investigations. So when you investigate, then you're able to generate the evidence. For us, we provide the leads. But before I report, I should make sure that I have sufficient evidence. Where am I going to get it from as an ordinary citizen of Uganda? So there are those dynamics, and that is because is they're going to be one to because they don't have sufficient resources to follow up each and every lead.
But there's some, I'm interested in, buno obulimu bwafo butono abayita ba investor waliwo kakati some people who claim that the foreigners are given more leeway and assistance to set up their small businesses here as compared to omuntu wawano. Omuntu wawano is more frustrated. Is there something we can do about it? I'll give you an example. I with no strings attached, Good African Coffee was very good. Ngabakosa coffee wafo wawano. Na ye, somehow they were, I understand they were frustrated out of business.
Yeah.
Because of some corruption, vichi, governor vichi, atel vichi. What advice can you throw some light on that? Are we actually frustrated and the others are given a bit more leeway?
Yeah, I think generally there is a tendency to favor foreigners as opposed to the locals, because we don't trust ourselves. And that has inculcated a culture, even us, when it comes to consumption of goods and services. If a commodity is manufactured outside Uganda, we feel safe and secure that is the quality is guaranteed, which is not necessarily the case. So therefore, when it comes to investments, I think there has been a lot of push for foreign direct investments as opposed to promoting local investments. And many companies have collapsed locally without a bailout. And many of the, for example, even if you looked at the Repost Uganda Investment Authority, they are telling you that we have registered so many foreign companies of this value in terms of dollars.
Imagine.
But none of those reports is actually indicating of this number of the 10 that we have registered this quarter, 8 of them are fully operational and they are found here and they are employing 500 Ugandans, and of the 500, 300 of them are girls, and 200 are boys, and they are earning their salary between 200 and 500,000.
Like
yes, so there is no such information. So many of these come and register, they allocated land. How many Ugandan companies can go to Uganda and get allocated land at Namave? Very few, unless if you highly connected.
Whatever you're Ugandan, so get to get
our culture beliefs.
Yes. So Somali again, they are no new passport. Uh-huh. In one day, they'll get it.
Our industrial park at Namave, most of them, probably about 98%, are doing assembling and packaging basically they are operating warehouses.
Mm.
Yeah. Mr. One Odoro. Of them you could give, say, Toyota Uganda. What is that? They manufacturing cars at Namave.
It's just an assembly ground. So, Jude, I want you to, you know, enlighten me with some of the innovative solutions that we could, put in place to fight corruption. As we get to celebrate Anti-Corruption Day today, what should we be looking forward as far as, you know, our quickest innovative solutions to make sure that we can curb the vice down?
The issue of the device is that we need what we call, I think, because of the too much politics and politicization of everything, is that we need political commitment. What we have in abundance is the political will. Everybody talks about the will to fight corruption, the will to do this, but in terms of the real action addressing the issue of corruption is where the challenge is. Is that there's supposed to be decisive actions. Is that, for example, there is an allegation of corruption, either it is a minister or a head of an agency or a head teacher of a primary school or an in charge of a health facility. But then these guys, they just say no, they just deny it and say no, the allegations are false. So how do we know that they are true? Is that every allegation at all levels in all government structures that somebody must be able to step aside immediately. As long as there is a smoking gun, somebody needs to step out of office. But people are fighting in office and nobody seems to be in charge to be able to get to the bottom of the issue. So that we need to make corruption expensive and costly. And once the message is sent across different levels, then people will appreciate the fact that, yes, this thing is real, it is serious, and therefore I must watch every step that I take. And that is the only way that you're going to inspire Ugandans. We've supported a lot of community association and engagement and empowerment work in terms of information, knowledge, and training. And we can say that what inspires Ugandans at the lowest level of service delivery point is when action is being done, okay?
Is it something
we can actually deal away with as an African country?
It is something that we can actually do because, for example, I believe the president when he says he has never taken a bribe. You get it? I can believe him that he has never taken a bribe.
Okay.
Yes. But I wouldn't believe that somebody is not taking on his behalf.
Thank you very much, Jude, for coming to the studio.
I am a mother, and I would like to ask on behalf of parents, what are the telltale signs that akana kagenda kubera corrupt?
One of them is absenteeism. Every time the child absents from school. Two is that excuses. Every time you give an excuse for not doing the right thing. That's one of the indicators of corruption. Therefore, that tilt shifts us away from the fight. And we see this every day when somebody is talking about corruption. Say, when they say government is corrupt, they say, but you also private sector, you're corrupt. Civil society, you're also corrupt.
Were you among the few Ugandans that were surprised because they saw Engineer Badru Chigundu being part of the anti-corruption work? Were you surprised as well?
Is that I was surprised, and above all, he was putting on the shorts. That meant that they were in the middle of corruption. That you can't afford to put on long trousers. So because
one
otherwise
way,
you get soaked.
If you wanted to arrest corruption, you should have just gone to Kololo on that day.
Thank you very much, Jude, for coming through to our studios. We have been trying to analyze the day that we are celebrating, this particular 9th of Monday, which is International Anti-Corruption Day, under the theme United Against Corruption. That means together we can bring the end to this big vice. Our venture today goes in for a very short break, but when we do get back, we begin the second hour with an interesting love letter.